and welcome to One Church ATL's live broadcast service. We are so excited that you have joined us today. You know, it's the heart of our pastors, our elders, our leadership team, and our church family that you feel God's love and His power through our praise and worship, through prayer, and the message. We hope and pray that you receive something special that you can apply to your everyday life. It is my hope and prayer that you are blessed by today's service. God bless.
Pray and thank you that you accept our praise today, God. We give you our best. God, I give you my best. Why? Because you gave us your best, God. We celebrate you, God. We honor you, God. We magnify you, God. You are a matchless God. You are an omniscient God. God, I love you. Right now, I pray, God, that you allow us to see what you see. God, we pray that we are able to see what you see. Use us, God, as your willing vessel, God, in the name of Jesus. God, I pray right now that your people say, yes. Yes, I'll serve you, God. Yes. Yes, I'll serve you, God. Yes. God, I thank you that you touched this word. None of me and all of you, God, in the name of Jesus. That your word be glorified and that it accomplish that which you've sent it to accomplish, God. We pray that it fall on good ground, God. And that our lives would never be the same, God. We honor you, God. We magnify your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Somebody give God a hand clap of praise. Because he's certainly worthy. God is worthy. I'm so honored. Thank you, my sister, for that praise, for that worship. I got to be honest, I did not know you had that in you. Praise God. I thank God for the gifts that are in this house. I could have just worshiped God all day because he is so good. He is so worthy to be praised. I thank God for you. And I'm excited to be sharing with you all today. I'm just excited that we have another opportunity to gather together. And that is so befitting because we're starting a new series today entitled Gathered. Gathered. And I'm going to be today continuing the conversation we had last week. We're going to today be talking about kingdom focus. Somebody say with me, kingdom focus. Let me hear you say that. I got to know you're with me today. Somebody say, kingdom focus. Hallelujah. We're going to be talking about the kingdom. We're going to be talking about the vision that God has given us. And I'm excited to share with you all today. We had an exciting time together last week. We celebrated the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. We celebrated the fact that he lives. He lives amongst us. And I love the revelation knowledge that God gave Pastor Stefan and I. We talked about the baton and how God so cleverly passed the baton to his son Jesus. Jesus completed the work here on earth. He redeemed us. And before he passed the baton to us, he empowered the Holy Spirit so that we could live right. He empowered the Holy Spirit so that we could walk right, so that we could be led and guided into truth. And so my question as we begin this new series entitled Gathered, where do we go from here? Where do we do now? What is our next step? The baton has been passed to us, mankind. What do we do with it? Hallelujah. Where do we go? What is our direction? And so we're going to be talking about it. I'm going to be reading a scripture, passage found in Matthew 6 today. But before I read that, I want to just share a little story with you all. My wife and I we moved to Atlanta in this area in 2003. We moved from Tulsa, Oklahoma. We had been there since 1991. We graduated from college in 95. Immediately after I graduated from college, I went into banking. And so when we knew that it was time for us to leave, when we knew it was time for us to move, we began to scout out cities. We came across Atlanta. Our family was moving here. And I did something I had never done in my life. I went out on the website and applied for a job. And literally a few days later, Bank of America called me. They called me and said, hey, Rod, we want you to come and we want you to interview with us. So I flew out here, interviewed. They liked what they saw. A week later, they offered me a job. 2 weeks later, I was living in Atlanta, Georgia, accepting a job in the banking industry. Now, mind you, before this job I accepted, I had been in banking for 8 years. So what I was going to do was nothing different than I had done in my previous job. But Bank of America, even though I had worked for Bank of Oklahoma for the previous 8 years, there were two things that there was important that they instilled in me before they allowed me to hire any employees, before they allowed me to touch $1, before they allowed me to step foot in the branch. They said, Rod, there's two things we need you to learn. There's two things you need to know. And they spent 8 months teaching me these two things before they even ever allowed me to do my job. And so today we're going to learn what those two things are. My passage today is found, if you have your Bibles, we're reading in the New King James Version. Going to be reading from Matthew 6, 25 through 34. Follow along with me. Now watch this. This is Jesus talking to his followers. He says, therefore I say to you, do not worry. I want to stop there because we're going to see that a few times in the passage. We're going to see Jesus implying to us that we do not worry. He says, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor your body, what you will put on. Is not your life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for neither they sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more value than they? Which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature? So here we see it again. Jesus is asking, why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lily of the fields, how they grow, neither toil nor spin. And yet I say unto you that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Here we see it again. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For all these things do the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things. Let me say that again. Your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things. Now, hear this right here. Here's Jesus changing the subject. He says, but instead of worrying about all these things, the King James Version says, take no thought, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you. Therefore, do not worry, here it is again, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Jesus is reminding us that we should not worry. In other words, he's saying, take no thought, don't worry about this. And what I love about this passage is the things that Jesus is asking us not to worry about are in many cases the things that we worry about. Society has taught us that there are many things that are important to survive. What does it say? We need what? Food, clothing, shelter. We need water. And all these things, Jesus didn't spend his time saying, don't worry about the Lamborghini. Don't worry about that three-story home that you want. He said, don't worry about the things that are important. And this society has placed an emphasis on these things. He says, don't worry about them. In other words, I need you to focus. Hear me on this. He says, I need you to focus on this one thing. Focus. In other words, you need to have vision. You need to have vision about what's important. Hear me out on this. So what Jesus was saying to his followers and his disciples today is the same thing that Bank of America wanted to teach me. Remember, I said there were two things that the bank wanted to teach me. Before they ever let me do my job, before they ever passed the baton to me, there were two things I needed to learn. I needed to learn their culture, and I needed to learn their vision. So the bank spent all of this time training me on two things. It's culture and it's vision. Because we in this society, we in this country, have confused religion with kingdom. This society has taught us things that were not in his kingdom. But the company taught me two things. Culture. Let's talk about that real quick. Culture. Company culture. What are we talking about? We're talking about core values. So here's what it means when I say core values. Those values and organization, hold that form the foundation on which they perform and conduct themselves. Listen to this definition. Those values underline how we work, how we interact with each other, and which strategies we employ to fulfill our mission. For 8 months, Bank of America, they didn't care that I had spent 8 years in banking. They didn't care that I already knew the job. It was important to them for me to learn how to conduct myself in their organization. Remember, we're talking about kingdom vision today. And before we run with this baton, we need to know how to conduct ourselves in a kingdom environment. Kingdom culture. We have to learn culture because America has taught us things about religion that's not true. Because what we have to understand about kingdom produces culture. Is anyone not from this country? Raise your hand if you're not from America. If you're not from America, there are things that you learned in your culture. These were not necessarily rules. See, religion produces rules. Kingdom produces a culture, a way of life. There's a way that we speak. There's a way that we interact with each other. There's a way that we conduct ourselves. Culture is important. When you go to Chick-fil-A, when you say thank you, what are they going to say? What are they going to say? They're going to say, my pleasure. You know why they're so important than selling chicken sandwiches and sweet lemonade? You know what's more important than selling some? Think about Chick-fil-A. When I go to Chick-fil-A right by my house, there's a YMCA right next to my house. So all the people that just got preaching healthiness and wellness, they're all in the Chick-fil-A line. Even though they understand they're getting ready to get some fried chicken and some syrupy, sugary lemonade. You know why they get in that line? They don't get in that line for the chicken. They don't get in that line for the Kool-Aid. Some of them, I eat Chick-fil-A and I don't even really like the chicken sometimes. We get in the line because that organization has created a culture that's attractive. And so we have to understand the difference between a kingdom culture and religion, because religion taught us, let me be honest with you, religion taught me that if my mother wore pants, she wasn't a part of the kingdom anymore. That's what religion taught me. Religion taught me that if my sisters put on makeup and lipstick, that they weren't a part of the kingdom. That wasn't kingdom, that was just religion. American Christianity has taught us division more than anything else has. American Christianity has taught us that you can serve a God that you've never seen, and your brother and sister that you see every day that doesn't look anything like you is no longer welcome into your house. That's what American Christianity has taught us. American Christianity has taught me that if I don't believe what you believe, elder, then I take my ball, I take my five or six people, and I go start another organization. That's why we have a church on every corner. Because we learn religion, we learn rules, we learn the do's and the don'ts, but we didn't learn the kingdom culture. So in order to pass this baton and us successfully run with it, we have to know what type of kingdom we are a part of. Because kingdom means that I preach the gospel whether I live or die. Kingdom means that I'm willing to sacrifice everything for the gospel. When I first got saved and when I accepted my calling, I was in Arkansas. Pastor came up to me. He says, Roderick, that's my legal name. He says, Roderick, I want to ask you a question. He says, if God spoke to you in an audible voice and says, son, I want you to go to a third world country where there's going to be danger. Your life is going to be in danger. But guess what? I am going to spare you. You will live. And you will return home to your family. Would you go if God spoke to you audibly? I said, yeah, probably. He said, okay, Roderick, let me ask you another question. He said, if God spoke to you and said, I'm going to send you to a third world country, but in that third world country where there's danger, you're going to be persecuted. And not only are you going to be persecuted, they're going to kill you and you will not return home to your family. Would you go then? And I could not answer that question. Because in this kingdom culture, we have to be willing to sacrifice it all. So let's talk about it. We're going to talk about kingdom. We're going to talk about vision today. I'm going to spend more time talking about the kingdom because I think society in our culture, we spend less time talking about it. So let's understand when we say the kingdom, what that means. So first of all, what is the definition? Let's look at the definition of kingdom. The definition of kingdom is a country, state, or territory ruled by a king. Rule a country, state, or territory ruled by a king. So there are a few components. I didn't bring them all with me today, but there are a few components that we need to understand about a kingdom. When you are in a kingdom, we're talking about the kingdom of God. What are some components? What are some things you should expect to see? Well, first of all, according to the definition, we are going to see that a true kingdom has a ruler. They are ruled by a king. And guess what? In this particular environment, the people didn't vote in the king. The king, especially the King of Kings, he is a king that will perpetually always be our ruler. Because we have to understand the environment that we're in the Americanized environment, we're in a democracy. So what does that mean we get to do? We have the opportunity to change authority. If we don't like the authority that we're under, if we don't like the ruler that we're under, what do we do? What do we do in November? We didn't like the authority, so what do? We voted him out. That's what happens in a democracy, not in a kingdom. In a kingdom, the king will always be the king. So once we understand that the king can't be voted in or out, then now that means we have, as a kingdom citizens, we have the obligation, watch this, to submit to the kingdom authority. So what does that mean? In this particular environment where we're submitting to the authority of the king, our will, listen to me, hear me on this, you and our will never ever be considered. What we want in a kingdom, the way we want to do it in a kingdom, will never ever be considered. Will always operate under the authority of the king. And what we've misconstrued the fact that God gave us free will, that we get to do it the way we want to do it. Even though God gave us free will, we still operate within a kingdom to where what he says goes. We don't get to make decisions about our life. We operate under the authority of Christ. And you know who knew that better than anyone? We saw that in the Bible when the centurion said, Jesus, I want you to come because my servant is ill. You all remember that story? I don't want to lose anybody. And Jesus said, I'll come to your home. But the centurion said, I don't even need you to come to my home. You know why? He says, because I understand kingdom authority. He says, because I'm in a kingdom. And in the kingdom that I'm in, rulership and authority has been given to me. So when I speak a word to one of my subordinates, I don't have to go follow that word and make sure it gets done. Because I am also a man of authority. So Jesus, because I understand your kingdom authority. I understand that you can speak the word, and in your kingdom, your word is the authority, and that my servant can be made whole. So the servant, the centurion, understood authority, and we have to understand it that way. When I hear people say, well, I'm just, even as a pastor, there's people that say, you know, pastor, I think it's time for me to move on. I don't think this whole church thing here is the place for me anymore. And I'm okay with that because I understand seasons. But let me tell you, since, you know, I'm your pastor, I'm your care pastor, if you ever come to me and say something you're getting ready to do that's getting ready to change your life, you can just rest assured I'm going to ask you one question. And this is the question I ask everyone. Is this God speaking to you? Are you subjecting and submitting yourself to the authority of the and the will of the Father? Because if you can't answer that question, then that lets me know that you're operating out of your will. And I don't understand that. I don't understand how we can, as kingdom citizens, make our own rules. When we're in a kingdom, we don't get to make our own rules. That's scary because there's things I would like to do. But I'm just like Jesus. When we're in a kingdom society, it's not our will. Jesus himself said, it's not my will, but God, your will be done. We learn that in a kingdom environment, kingdom culture means that we submit ourselves to the king. Our life is not our own. We don't get to make our own decisions. Number two, what is something else that happens in a kingdom environment? In a kingdom environment, you have territory. In every kingdom, you're going to have territory. Let me help you to understand that the enemy understands territory sometimes better than we do. Remember when Satan attempted to tempt Jesus to bow down? What was he getting him to bow down? He wanted to give him territory. He was tempting Jesus with territory that he had influence over. The enemy understands territory. Remember in the Bible when Jesus was about to cast the demon out of the man in the Gadarenes, he looked at the demon. He looked at the demon and asked the demon, what was his name? What was the response of the demon? He said, my name is Legion, for we are many. And so Jesus, if you read that scripture, the Bible says Jesus was prepared to cast him out into the deep. The demons begged Jesus not to be cast out into the deep. They say, Jesus, don't cast us out into the abyss. Perhaps allow us to go into this nearby herd of swine. Jesus permitted them to go into the herd of swine. Why do you think the demons didn't want to be cast out into the deep? Come on, my Bereans. Why did the demons want to stay in the herd of swine? Because they wanted to remain in the territory. They wanted to stay in that region. That's the reason when you go to the doctor, he always asks you, what is your medical history? He's asking you, what is in your territory? What is in your history? The enemy operates by territory. There are spirits that we see in certain cities. When you go to Las Vegas, there is a spirit in that city. When you come into Atlanta, there's a spirit. There's a territorial assignment here. And so the enemy understands territory. In a kingdom environment, then we have to also understand that God works through territory. How did we see that? We saw David. David in the Bible is one of my favorite men of God. And now we see two times that God says that David is a man after his own heart. We saw it in the Old Testament. We saw it in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, it was 1 Samuel 13 and 14. Right before Samuel anointed David, he said, this is a man after God's own heart. Now, I can understand that because David had not done anything wrong yet. He's a young, pure young man that loves God. He's excited. He trusts God in everything that he does. And so, but what happens after that? After that, David runs into some challenges in his life. Yeah, remember, he was the one that under his leadership mismanaged the Ark of the Covenant. And Uzziah died. Remember David, he was the one that on the terrace one day, he sees another man's wife named Bathsheba, and he decides to commit adultery with her. Remember David? David was the one that after he committed adultery with Bathsheba, he then had her husband Uriah killed. That David, the same David that had a son, Amnon, that raped his half-sister, and David did nothing about it. Even after all of these things happen, when we turn over to Acts 13 and 22, we see Paul reminding us that David was still a man after God's own heart. He even went on to say because God was so pleased with David that he allowed his seed to flow through him that eventually came our Savior. So it wasn't that David had made the least amount of mistakes that God did not change his mind about him. I'm coming back to my point. It was that David understood territory. David understood God's will, and David expanded the kingdom of Israel. So David became a man after God's own heart because he understood kingdom expansion. He understood territory expansion. So what does that mean to us? As citizens of the king, we must understand the responsibility we have to expand God's territory. You all understand that? But also, other than rulership, other than the territory, there's also this thing called laws that you're going to see in a kingdom. In every kingdom, there are going to be laws. Now, the difference between us and America is in America, it's the will of the people. The people vote in the authority. They vote in the rules by the congressmen and that they elect. In a kingdom, the laws, the constitution is dictated by the king. The king doesn't ask our permission to enact and legislate laws. We're in a system to where the king creates the law. So when Jesus said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness," what does that righteousness mean? The righteousness means being in right standing with God's laws, being in right standing with God's precepts, being in right standing with God's constitution. So when God speaks his word, it becomes our responsibility. So we have a responsibility if we want to please God. He says all those other things, all the things that you're concerned about, food, clothing, and shelter, and where we're going to live, and all those things, water. He says, I'll take care of those things if you understand and operate within my kingdom culture, and not only operate within my kingdom culture, that you also continue to remain in right standing with God. What God has said to us, the provisions that he's laid. You can't understand God's provisions if you don't read the manual. If you don't read the Constitution, how can we expect to govern ourselves by provisions and decrees that God has made and we don't even understand or know what it says? He says, there's two things, my kingdom and my righteousness. We have that responsibility. And the last thing that I want to talk about as far as a kingdom, you're going to have rulers, you're going to have territory, you're going to have laws. In every kingdom, you're going to have an army. You're going to have an army. And so we see an army. We see the army is the protection of the kingdom. And so that's what we have to understand, that if we get outside, and the only thing I want to say about this is we should not get outside of the protection of the armies of the living God. And sometimes we want to isolate ourselves. We want to get outside the protection and the provision of God. What happened? What did David say to Goliath? David knew that he could beat Goliath. He said this one thing. He wasn't worried about artillery. He wasn't worried about weaponry. He said, I see that this giant has defied the armies of the living God. How dare you? Because you are outside of God's covenant. And so we have to make sure that we stay under the protection of the army of God. What does that mean? That's why I love this assembly. We are never here at One Church going to underestimate the interaction. We at One Church here are never going to underestimate the assembly, the provision of us coming together as one army. But when you step outside, and what we do a lot of times is when we start having issues, when we start having challenges in life, what's the first thing we do? We stop being connected to the army that God has placed with us and provided and given us provision. We want to fight alone. So what does the enemy do? When the enemy sees us outside of the protection of the army, he says, okay, there's a target right there. That person isn't covered. That person has stepped outside of the covering of the army. So my point that I want to make on the fact that a kingdom has an army is that we as kingdom citizens, our conduct should be that we remain in the army of the living God. Can you say amen on that? Now watch this. Just for a moment, I want to talk about vision, because we're talking about being kingdom focused. We're talking about having kingdom vision. So when we say vision, what is the definition? The ability to think about or plan the future with imagination or wisdom. So we're not talking about sight. I just want to make that clear. Sight is what you see with your eyes open. Vision is what you see with your eyes closed. We're going to talk about vision and the vision that God has given us as the body of Christ to run with this baton and to run this race. Because the scripture, let me read the scripture. Habakkuk 2:2 says, write the vision. You all have read this before. And make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. Listen to me, my friends. It says, but at the end it will speak and it will not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. God is teaching us, just like the organization, when they first hired me, they wanted to teach me culture. They wanted to teach me how to operate, how to act, how to interact, how to fulfill vision, mission. But they also wanted to teach me their mission. They wanted to teach me the direction in which they were going. And that's what God teaches us with vision. He teaches us the direction in which he is going. So let's look at this. The first thing it says is to make it plain. And let me say this to you. God's vision is plain. What do I mean by plain? Let me use another word. God's vision is clear. Now let me say this to you. God's vision is clear to him. It may not always be clear to us. There's things that God asked me to do that didn't make sense. When we started Greater Works Fellowship, we were having 2 or 3 people come to Bible study, and God says, go find a building. On paper, it didn't make sense. But God says to write it down, make it plain. So once I understood God's vision, hear me out on this, then I needed to move with it. Because there's 2 things that God wants to accomplish when we write down what he says to us. Number one, God wants to show and have history be a witness to his revelation. When he tells us to do something, he wants history to be able to document the fact that he moved the way that he said he would move. But the other thing that God wants to do when he gives us vision and we write it down is he wants to be glorified. He wants to get the glory, because guess what happens in a kingdom, my friends? Do you all understand what happens in a kingdom? We don't get the glory. We're just ambassadors for Christ. We don't get the glory. God gets the glory. And so he wants us to write it down, so when he fulfills, because he says it will not lie. There are some things God told me when I was 18 years old. It was so big that it blew my mind. There are some things that God shared with me about church that I have not even shared with Pastor Bell, because he would think I was crazy. There are some things that God tells us to do that right now, when he says it to us, it does not make any sense. But write it down, because God wants to be glorified. God needs. So when God creates vision, guess what he needs? When God creates vision, he needs willing vessels. He needs us to be willing. He needs us to be willing vessels. Now watch this. Because vision for us is necessary. Vision is necessary for life, the Bible says. Proverbs 29:18 says the people die or perish because of lack of what? Vision. For where there is no vision, the people perish. So why do we need vision? Why does God give us direction? Why does he allow us to see where he's going? So that the vision can create boundaries. We need boundaries in our life. If I'm running a race, I don't need to get so far off course. So the vision gives me perspective. The vision keeps me on pace. The vision not only creates boundaries, it creates restraint. The vision creates restraint. Do you understand what I'm saying? Without revelation from God, the people run wild. Without revelation from God, the people run wild. We need vision. So before God passed us this baton, he needed to make sure that we had direction, because everything that he now wants to do here on earth, guess what? He's going to do it through his children. The vision needed a willing vessel. But watch this. It says, he who may read it may run with it. That's powerful. You got to get that. He who may read it may run with it. What does that mean? That the vision that God gives us, we have to put it into motion. The vision should create motion. It should create movement. It should create action. And that's why I get nervous when people, and this is just me. Maybe this is just my own thing. But I get nervous when people always say to me they're waiting on God. That just makes me nervous sometimes. I'm just being honest with you. I get nervous when every time I talk to you, your response to me is that you're waiting on God. And I know sometimes we have to wait, and there's times where we do have to be still. But if you've been waiting on God for 2 years to do something, when I understand that vision creates movement, if I'm sitting in the same place this year that I was last year waiting on God, then I realize now, by now, God is now waiting on me. So you have to ask yourself the question, with the vision that God has given us, with all the movement that's required, with all the action that's required, are we waiting on God or is he waiting on us? Because the vision requires us to have faith. The vision requires that we trust. The vision that God gives us is nothing more than a trust exercise. We have to trust what God is saying will come to pass. And that's what we mean when we talk about vision, kingdom vision. Kingdom vision typically always creates discomfort. Because when you look at what God asks you, it never seems like you have enough. It never seems like you have enough money. It never seems like you have enough time. It never seems like you have enough people. But when God gives us vision, he creates the provision. So what we have to do, let me say this to you. What we have to do as kingdom citizens is we have to get comfortable being uncomfortable. So when we talk about kingdom vision, that wasn't just for us believers. God didn't just create us and save us to put us on the sidelines. I'm closing here. But God, when he gave us kingdom vision, his design was that we bear fruit. And that's the reason that Paul said in, I believe it was Romans 10 and 14, he says, how the people are going to hear? How are they going to hear unless there be someone that preached to them? How are the people now going to know and learn who Christ is? What is this message about as a kingdom citizen, as an ambassador, as the New Testament calls us? What is this about? What is this kingdom vision about? It's about us carrying the baton and spreading the gospel. This is a message about evangelism. This is a message about the responsibility, and you're going to hear this message from Pastor Bell and I. God has us in the vein, and my mentor used to say this to me all the time. He says, Rod, when you share vision, he says, share it 7 times. And once you think they've got it, share it 7 more times. We cannot get enough of understanding what's important to the kingdom of God. Jesus, the very last thing he said to us, what did he say to us in Matthew 28 and 19? And by the way, if you want to understand one church's vision, if you want to understand the culture here at one church, it's Matthew 28 and 19. He says, go ye therefore into the nations, teaching them and baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. That is the culture here. That is the vision that we have. And how do we do it, one church? We do it as one unified army. That is our vision, that we go into the nations. We go as one unified army. We've assembled ourselves together, not just to look pretty and laugh and shake each other's hand and hug on each other. Those things are great. But we come here to fuel ourselves and to tool ourselves so that we can go for that person that hasn't heard the gospel, that needs a preacher. Paul says, how can they hear unless someone preach to them? They need someone. We're all preachers. From that regard, we all have a responsibility to share this gospel. If you've accepted Christ into your life, then you have a responsibility to share the kingdom, culture. How do we conduct ourselves in a kingdom? We conduct ourselves by understanding that the authoritarian God himself, the King of glory, that has created dominion for us here on earth. Even God created dominion for us here to rule and to spread his word. Because even when you talk about a dominion, you have to have a domain. What is a domain? Domain is a territory that's controlled by a ruler. God gave us dominion to expand his territory here on earth. And when we say kingdom vision, it simply means that we conduct ourselves in a way that's different than we conduct ourselves in a democracy. We don't get to do what we want to do. My wife and I have had intense discussions in the past about us having to do what God told us to do. And there were times we didn't want to walk this life. We didn't want to walk this walk. But we had to say, just like Jesus did, that God, I would rather just live my life. I would rather just run my businesses. I would rather just live my life. But God says, no, son, I've called you to the people. I've called you to spread this gospel. I've called you to carry this baton. I've called you to teach love to my people. Are you willing to go, or are we willing to sit back and say, I don't feel like it? He says, not my will, but your will be done. How many of us have surrendered ourselves to the authority in the kingdom, under the kingdom in which we reside? Have we completely surrendered everything to him? Are we still holding on to some things? Are there some things that we're still being stagnant about? Have we completely released our life over to God? Kingdom vision means bearing fruit. Remember, Jesus said, not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, is going to enter in just because we can talk a good game. He says, but those that are operating in the kingdom and are doing my will, that are doing the will of the Father. Because remember, we said the Father is in charge, and he's created his will through his laws and his constitution and his decrees and his word. He says those that have sought the kingdom, that understand kingdom culture and are in right standing with God, those are the ones that are going to be blessed. So I implore you today, I implore you to re-examine your theology. Re-examine how we operate in this kingdom. We are in a kingdom environment. Let's stop acting like we're in a democracy where we have choice. Let's stop acting like it's the will of the people. It's not the will of the people. Let's stop pacifying ourselves. Let's stop pacifying other people. In the kingdom, it's the will of the Father. We have the responsibility to spread this gospel to the nations. I know there are people here today, just to show you how this works. There are people today visiting our service that only met us online. They met us through other ways to spread the gospel. So as God is creating and instilling in us purpose and direction, we have to understand in this day and age, we have to be creative. That we just can't expect everybody to turn themselves into that building over there and come in and see us and say, I want to be saved. It's not going to happen like that. We as ambassadors, we need to understand that God is deploying us in the marketplace so that we can spread the gospel and see it. Kingdom vision is seeing it through the lens of our Heavenly Father. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. I hope this word was good for you today. It's not always about us getting excited. We need to understand kingdom culture. There are certain things you do when you go to certain cultures. In certain cultures, they eat on the ground. They eat sitting down on the ground. When we eat here, we typically sit in a chair. You need to understand the culture in which you reside in. My friends, we are in a kingdom culture. We have to act like it. We act as if we're in a democracy. We can't be lackadaisical with the baton. When somebody needs us to run down their street, when somebody needs us to run down their lane and simply just say, God loves you, we can't make it about ourselves. This baton that God has passed to us is about his people, because he loved them so much that he says, I'm going to send you, Kim. I'm going to send you, Felisa, because I know I can trust you to love on my people. And so God is passing us this baton. We have to understand the culture, and we have to understand that God has given us direction to save souls in these last days. Culture and vision. Before we do anything, let's learn the kingdom culture and the vision. Jesus spent all of his life, if you read the Bible, Jesus didn't spend his time talking about healings. Jesus didn't spend his time talking about homosexuality, not a lot of time. What did he spend most of his time talking about? The kingdom of heaven. So let's make sure that we spend ample amount of time understand how to conduct ourselves in the kingdom. God bless you all. God bless you. I love you. Pastor Bell and I, we love you. We thank God for you today. And I'll just say this as we prepare to leave. If there's anyone here that says, Pastor Rod, I hear you talking about this kingdom culture, and I just want to accept God. I want to know Jesus and the power of his resurrection. I want to know Jesus a little better. I want to accept Jesus into my life. I want to start there. And then I want to start learning about this kingdom that you spoke of. If that's you today, just either raise your hand or honk your horn at me today. It says, we would be remiss not to give an opportunity, an invitation for someone to experience the glory that we've experienced through our relationship with Jesus Christ. Okay? So no one raised their hands, no one honked their horns. That means we all have the responsibility. That means we've accepted the baton. So now we know what to do with it. We run the race. We run the race. We run the kingdom race. And we run laser focus, not on these things of the world. God says he'll take care of those things. As my own children, I have two daughters. Because they are a representation of me, I don't let them leave the house. My wife and I, sometimes our daughters are thinking they're about to leave the house dressed a certain way. No, ma'am, you can't leave the house dressed that way. Why? Because you are a reflection of the green name. Put on some more clothes. But I would never let anything happen to my children, my beautiful daughters, because they're a reflection of me. How much more our Heavenly Father, because he's sending us to the nations, are going to take care of all those things. I saw you. I saw you when I said, do not worry. I saw some of you say, oh, my God, this message is for me. Why? Because you've been worrying. I see you in the spirit. God says to you today, do not worry about that. Focus on my kingdom. Do not worry about how you're going to eat. Do not worry about what you're going to drink. Do not worry about how the mortgage is going to get paid. Take no thought of these things, but first seek my kingdom and my righteousness. Amen. God bless you all.
Thank you for tuning in to One Church ATL Live Service. We pray that you are blessed by today's message. Now please tune in every Sunday at 10 a.m. and join us live here on Facebook. God bless and have a wonderful week.
Thank you for tuning in to our live One Church ATL broadcast. One Church ATL continues to be actively involved with spreading the gospel and impacting lives in our local community. Because of your continued financial support, we've been able to support our first responders and agencies directly involved with supplying resources to those in need. Our ministry has partnered with food distribution centers to assist with the immediate needs of our community, and we've been able to address needs right here within the body of Christ. Your continued support is appreciated as we spread the gospel of the kingdom through giving. On behalf of One Church ATL, we want to say thank you for giving. We pray your resources continue to be blessed.